everyone. Thanks for joining us from beautiful Dodger Stadium. I am Maria Serrao, joined today by Will Lupardus. And Will, we are here. The Dodgers have clinched.
Yeah.
They are going to the playoffs. This is the final homestand against the Padres. They've got three games against the Pods, and then it's going to be the Mets. But we don't know if it will start here at Dodger Stadium or start in New York, and we're not going to know this until the end of the weekend.
Right. Sunday, right? We're at the beginning of the series right now on Friday, right. These last three games will mean everything to a lot of teams.
Right. Yes. But for the Dodgers and the Mets, it's crazy because they're dead even right now. But we did just find out that if the Mets and Dodgers should tie, the Mets won the season between the two teams, so it will go to the Mets. They'll start in New York and not here. But if it starts here, the big plus for us is that it may start in shadows, and nobody wants to stay hit against Kershaw and Greinke anyway, let alone if there are shadows. So maybe that gives us a little bit of an edge. We'll see.
Yeah, if they can win out these last three games, I think we start here and probably take the first two games, hopefully.
That's right. Now, that would be great in theory, but the Mets do have some really good players, as we've talked about. They've got the big three as far as pitching goes. It's been a question for the Dodgers. You know, would it be Alex Wood? Would it be Mike Bolsinger? Would it be Anderson? He played really well last night, but, you know, it's such a drop-off, honestly, after Kershaw and Greinke, you know, and it has been.
Yeah, you got to rely on the hitters, but the good thing is the hitting has been pretty good for the Dodgers this latter part of the season, so regardless of who that third pitcher is, I like the Dodgers' chances against the Mets, whether they start in New York or L.A.
I'm keeping my fingers crossed because we need to get to that World Series. It's been too many years. Since 1988 since the Dodgers have been to the World Series. That's just too long.
Way too long. We've seen a lot of players come and go that
have
made the series. What's commendable, though, is this is the third straight year the Dodgers have made the playoffs, and that I don't think that's ever happened, has it?
It's never happened, and I think we have to give Don Mattingly a little bit of credit there because he has managed well enough to get them to three playoffs, three consecutive years, which is that's a pretty big job.
Yeah, since you can definitely say this new ownership has kept some pieces correctly in order to get these regular season wins. Now we are about a week away from seeing if this team can be successful in the playoffs, which has been a little difficult for them in these last few successful years.
It has. Now, something that we missed because we were not in San Francisco when they clinched was the champagne celebration. And, well, you and I have been in there. I see the look in your eye right now because it is absolutely crazy in there. And you could just see it. But what I thought was funny, the first thing I noticed was now everybody has designer goggles in there because the champagne, the beer, like there would be like random ones. In fact, a couple years ago, one of the relief pitchers stole Gino, our cameraman. They stole his goggles, and I'm sure he still has them wherever he's playing right now. But now they've got like, you know, matching goggles. Everybody has goggles in there.
Sure.
And it's crazy.
You gotta protect your eyes. It really does sting.
It does sting.
I mean, it's sugary, grape sparkling juice. So
yes.
Yeah, it's gonna sting. I suggest if the Dodgers do well and, you know, hopefully we see some more champagne.
Yes.
I suggest you get bedazzled goggles.
Bedazzled goggles.
I think that's
goggles.
Befitting of
So
Maria
I need Serrao. Bedazzled goggles. I was thinking, because I always do the baseball hat, and I was thinking of maybe bedazzling at least the Dodger logo or something,
yeah,
right?
Some
I
need diamonds to do something. Outside of the LA logo?
Yeah, that'd be a good idea. I think that's a good plan.
I think so. And the bill would shield some of the champagne.
Exactly.
But still have you can drink some extra spray. So.
Well, here's my thing is, you know, they're dumping, there was 200 bottles of champagne, okay?
Really?
200, a very expensive champagne, and most of it ends up on the floor. They're not even enjoying, well, they're enjoying it, but
yeah. They're
not enjoying it. You know, they're spraying it all over
yeah.
the place. Then they go to beer, and then they did a weird thing the other night where there was like baby powder going on in there.
Yeah.
Which we gotta ask somebody about.
Does that come from LeBron James?
I don't, did it? Did he start that?
Yeah.
Yeah. It was like, I'm like, what is all that?
I think he uses talc powder so it sticks, your hands stick to the basketball. I mean, baby powder
Interesting.
Is.
Interesting. Okay.
Who knows what those guys are doing?
I thought that was
really
weird.
I mean, they're
using
champagne for some kind of hair treatment, is really all they're doing.
Yeah.
Very little's going in their mouth.
It was, yeah, well, very little was going
it's
in their mouth.
It's just kind of a dumping thing.
Yeah, it's a dump. And we've been dumped on and sprayed on, and it is pretty fun. But after a while, you're like, wow, this is cold and wet and sticky.
Well, they're giving the fans what they want right now, so
that's it.
So I think they deserve a champagne toast and hopefully a few more.
And you know what? It was pretty sweet to do it in San Francisco in front of the Giant fans, even though, you know what, Giant fans, congrats. You guys have had three World Series in 5 years, and
yes. You
deserve it. You have had a great run. As my niece always reminds me, well, we have had three in 5 years. And I'm like, well, you're right. You have. Got to give them credit. They're a great team.
Much respect to the Giants.
Much respect.
Great city, San Francisco.
Yes.
And the organization was nice enough when the Dodgers clinched to put a big congratulations, LA Dodgers.
Such
on
class.
Jumbotron.
Yeah, such class. You know what, Dodger fans and Giant fans get a lot of nastiness between them, but you know what? It's nice to see fans coexisting together. That's what sports is about,
yeah.
You know?
I think the true nastiness is a very minimum.
I think so, too.
The good people that root for the Dodgers and the Giants are what we should focus on.
That's right. All right, when we come back, we're going to talk more Dodgers. We've got some big news to report on, which we're going to talk about next. You're watching Playing the Field.
We are back with Playing the Field, where we are literally on the field at Dodger Stadium.
We're playing on the field, all right?
Now, Maria, you got this. We are playing on the Dodger Stadium.
Yes,
field.
We are.
And the king of the Dodgers, the patriarch of the Dodgers.
The godfather of baseball.
The guy that we all love. Shared laughs with.
Yes.
A real member of the Rat Pack.
Exactly. Yeah, I love the picture they have of him with Frank Sinatra. They have a few of them throughout the stadium, but it's just so classic Tommy with him and Sinatra hanging out. You know?
Yeah, he's a true living legend, and we're lucky enough to get to see him around here. Now you got to sit down with him because he penned a book.
He did. He wrote a book this year with his longtime assistant Colin Gunderson. It was entitled My Way. And anytime you get to sit down with Tommy Lasorda in his office, it's an experience. Let's take a look. This would be the current book that we're talking about right now, and this is My Way. It's so interesting to me. The first thing that I really felt when I was reading it was that you've touched so many people, and they can't wait to tell stories about you. Who was your greatest influence growing up?
Well, my father was, number one. He taught us. He was not, an educated man, per se. But he taught us respect. He taught us how to conduct ourselves. Mm-hmm. He told us that it didn't cost you anything to say hello to somebody. Didn't say it cost you any money to be nice to people. And that was his philosophy of life. And then on the table, my mother had a can of carnation milk. What possessed me to pick up that can and read it, and on it says, contented cows give better milk. And I took that with me all those years, and I said, it must be contented players give better performance.
Wow.
So I used that slogan for many years.
When you think back to some of those times, was your dad a storyteller like you?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And I think about him all the time because he belonged with the hunting club. A group of young guys. They're all young, but he was older. So he'd take me to the meeting. And I would see him there, and he maintained the attention of those young guys, telling them stories and everything. Every time I do one, I think about my father.
You know, it's funny because I've known you for a very long time now, and when I read the Joe Torres, the Collins, the people that in this book are written about, it was always a moment in their lives. They remember you saying something. How did you kind of think to do that in certain times for certain people?
Well, you can look back and see how many people were nice to you, how many people were friends with you. Mm-hmm. And I was so proud of my players. Mm-hmm. I loved each and every one of them. And I couldn't wait till I get to the ballpark to be with them. And I established a relationship with players and their families. Mm-hmm. I figured if I knew the player, I'll know the family much better, and that would make it an easy knowing the family too. So that's what I did. I used to know every player's wife's name, every player's children's name, and when I came to manager, before me, Walston, he wouldn't let youngsters in the clubhouse.
Really?
Yeah. So I changed that rule when I became the manager. I said, you guys are away from home so much. When you get home, you want to spend time with your son. Bring him here. Bring him. Go out in the field and work with him if you want to. But when it's time for you to start your work and everything, then you got to get him out of here, see?
That's the Italian side of you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And in fact, that when John Shelby got traded to Detroit, his kids used to call me Uncle Tommy. And he said, He went to Sparky. He said, "We're not allowed in your clubhouse, but Uncle Tommy let us in his clubhouse all the time." Sparky got mad at me.
So now, do all the clubs let people have their kids in there now?
No.
Oh, no, really? No. Wow, I did not know that you had started that.
Yeah, some that don't want them around.
Wow. Well, that's definitely not the case here. And even the current Dodgers, I know you've spent so much time with. We just had a chance to talk to Andre Ether about you, and he was reminiscing about you over the years and the first time he met you. You still know so much about every one of the guys that come up that are here.
Well, yeah. Well, I try to help when any of them are having trouble. I always try to talk to them and try to get them on the right track. Mm-hmm. And that's the part I love. And I love going all over the country speaking to people. Mm-hmm. I love people. And I tell them, every time I talk to a group of people, I tell them, look, this game doesn't belong to the owners. This game doesn't belong to the players. This game belongs to the fans. And I'll tell you why. You can have the greatest ball team, greatest stadium, and if nobody goes through those turnstiles, you're going to have to shut the doors down. We need the fans. And I always made a point to the fans that anything we do it for them too.
You know, there's so much talk about numbers nowadays, but you always know how to bring the human element into it, that these are real guys playing a game on the field together. How do you sort of get past the front office stuff to talk about, these are still guys on the field that we need to remember?
These are the guys that make the team go good.
That's right.
That's the main thing. You know, Al Campanis once said to me, "You can't go out and eat with the players." And I said, "Why not?" He said, well, I never went out and ate with the manager. I said, "Well, maybe they didn't want you to meet with them." I said, "But I go out and eat with them." I said, "If I'm speaking at one of these clubs, and I have my players there, and we sit and eat lunch, what do I do, move away from them?" So I go out and eat with the players.
Sure.
Why not? I can eat with them and still see. They think if you eat with them and get close to them, you won't correct them when they need it, or you won't give them a shout if you. I didn't care. That never stopped me from doing what I had to do on that field.
You know, it's interesting to me because when I was reading through the book, you talk a lot about motivation, determination, a winning attitude. And I think that it's rubbed off on many managers who didn't think that way, but then they remembered you and what worked. And well, now they're like that.
You know, Joe Torre, when he became the manager here.
Yep.
And I was at the press conference and he said, "Look at Tommy Lasorda there." He said when he came to manage in the major leagues, he hugged his players.
That's right.
We laughed at him. Now we all do it.
Yep, that's very true. Well, that just shows the love and the togetherness that you have always promoted. This team now, I'm sure every year you look at the Dodger team, nobody wants to win more than you do, that's for sure. What is your idea now? What are your thoughts on the makeup of the team right now?
Well, I think you're seeing out a lot of talent out there.
Mm-hmm.
Talent which, I have a saying, talent which is used becomes successful. Talent which isn't used is what's washed away. It's no good.
Mm-hmm.
You got to utilize whatever talents God gave you.
Yep.
And you got to put every minute of your heart into the game. And when they had tough times, I put my arm around them.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of managers won't even talk to guys when they're having tough times.
Right.
That's the time they need you more than they hit a home run. They run around the base. They don't care if you shake their hand. They're getting they got the handshake when they hit the home run, and then they got the handshake from the players when he gets in the dugout. They don't need me with them.
Right.
They need me when they're scuffling, they're tired, they're not doing well, and I have to be there to protect them. I have to be there to help them. I have to be there to motivate them, and I have to be there to tell them, "Hey, I love you, and whatever we do it together." You know, when they play the national anthem, I always thank God because he made it all happen for me. And if I could have, sat down and wrote on a piece of paper, kind of wife I want, they couldn't write a better one than the one I have.
Well, he wrote the script for you, and of course, Your Way, My Way, the title of the book. Really great stories in this book, so get it and read about this great man right here that I am so honored to call a friend. Thank you so much for spending time with us.
I'm reading that book for a second time.
You are?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's hard for me to read books.
Is it?
Yeah, I fall asleep right away.
Well, trust me, you're not going to fall asleep reading this one because the stories are good. Here's another really funny thing about Tommy Lasorda is you tell him it's going to be a 10-minute interview, and then he's done about 25 minutes later, and that's just the way it goes with Tommy because he likes to talk a lot, and you want to hear what he has to say.
Yeah, he has a couple stories.
Yeah, he does.
He's the best.
You know, it's funny. For his birthday this year, he sat down with a couple of the younger Dodgers, and what I think is so cool is that it doesn't matter if he is in his late 80s and they're in their 20s. They can relate. He relates to them, and there is nobody on this earth that doesn't relate to Tommy Lasorda. It's amazing.
Yeah, he has a wonderful sense of humor and a great way. If you, you know, embrace him,
yes,
he will kind of dig at you, as he has me a couple times.
Yeah, he does.
But it's hilarious.
It is, yeah.
He's like having a grandpa out here that loves to kind of give you some crap. But he's a very lovable man.
He really is. He really is. He loves being out here every day. And there's nothing he would like more than to win a championship. I can tell you that. That's sure. For sure. Now, somebody we haven't seen a lot of, at least over the last month, is Yasiel Puig. With the playoffs just right around the corner, if he's well enough, do they put him back out there, or do they not put him back out there?
Well, everybody is a Dodger fan, or a Dodger, wants Yasiel Puig to be on the playoff roster. But you're right, the core of this success we've had, at least in the latter part of the season, has been guys like Seager and
right.
Jock Peterson.
Andre Ethier, who's been just consistent out
right.
there. So it's becoming a question, what do they do? With an arm like he has that he can throw the ball to, you know, New Hampshire from here, I mean, it seems really, like, how do you not have him on that roster? On the other hand, do you put him back in there with virtually no playing time?
It's a nice problem to have. You never know what's going to happen in the playoffs, though, where
That's
you need
the problem.
Substitution. Injury's always possible, so... So for Puig to be at least a backup.
Available. Right.
Yeah,
I think that's important.
I think that's something we will see. And it'll be up to Mattingly and how the guys are doing, how the team is doing against the Mets, frankly.
Right.
To know if we even see Puig at all, if we even need him, you know.
And we're hearing that the front office is very fond of Puig. And as we know, they've had some influence over what goes on here at the Dodgers. So just saying, you know, yeah. He might be out there. And I like having him at least here, so I'm hoping he'll be around, and, you know, I think he's good for the team.
Yeah. Well, what do you I mean, he did cause some disruption, you know, there was times he was late. So, frankly,
that was a while ago. I think that this is getting so blown out of proportion with him that, okay, yes, he had some issues that went on, but how long are we going to hold that over this guy's head? I mean...
Well, how long will Mattingly hold him over it?
Well, I don't think it's really so much Donnie as I think it's... too much of the media that wants to keep bringing it up and talking about Puig and, you know, he did this, he did that. So I think that it's really going to be about who gives them the best chance to win. And at the end of the day, we're going to find that out, like you said, when the Mets get here and what's going to happen with that.
His hitting abilities and
amazing.
Everything he can do in the outfield, you want the guy in the playoff roster. And I hope we see some at-bats from Puig.
I hope we do, too. Now, somebody that we hadn't seen a lot of at-bats from is Corey Seager. He came up this last month, and he has been so much fun to watch, and I had a chance to catch up with him. Let's take a look. Welcome to Dodger Stadium. I know you started on the road. How have things been for you since you got here?
It's been fun. You know, the crowd's fun. It's always fun to play in front of your home crowd, and, you know, it's you guys like this to stand there and just watch. But it's been good. You know, it's been a blast so far.
Has Kike put any bananas in your locker yet? Or?
No, not yet. I'm still waiting for that one, so we'll see.
Is he
sharing your locker now? Or?
No, he doesn't. No, he's in the bathroom.
is that the whole Ricky thing?
No, it's just a Corey Seager thing. Future franchise.
There you go.
Yeah.
Okay. And then, of course, Coach Wallach, you know, he's up here helping you out as well.
Yeah, you know, everybody's been great so far like that. Just little stuff like that, you know, that's that's what keeps the clubhouse light, and that's what keeps it fun. If you embrace it, it's a lot of fun.
You know, it's interesting because you come up and you seem very calm, kind of composed, and I think that it's a surprise to everybody because you think, well, it's such a big jump. But how did you sort of keep composed after all this time?
We have a lot of good veterans, you know, and when they lead you in the right path, you know, it's easy to jump in there and kind of fill the spots when needed. And I can give a lot of credit to them. And you know, I have an older brother I've had a lot of conversations with and stuff, so it's been an easier adjustment for me.
I was going to ask you that. What kind of advice does he give you, having been in the system for a while?
You know, he's given me advice all through my career, you know, even when I was in high school and stuff. Every time I need a question, he's kind of the guy that I've gone to, and he's been helpful so far. And he's just kind of told me to soak in everything and have fun and kind of enjoy the moment.
Is it going by fast for you while you're here, or are you slowing it down a little bit?
You know, it's slowing down a little bit, but the days still are going by fast. You know, when you're having fun, stuff tends to fly by. So it's going by fast, but it's still slow during the day.
Marie, as we wrap up this baseball season, 2015, we have learned some surprising news about one of our beloved here at Dodger Stadium.
One of our favorites. Nancy B. Heffley is going to announce her retirement. Well, she'll be back here and there for some special games, but yeah, it's been a long time. She was here during the last World Series in 1988, and she's been here ever since, so it's been a very long time. Fans, of course, love her. We love her, and the press box will not be the same without Nancy B. Heffley up there. That is for sure.
Yeah, she's tickled the ivories for 27 years.
That's it.
And I know I'm going to miss her.
I'm going to miss her so much. It's going to be crazy. But I'll, of course, see her. We'll see her because we're friends with her. So we are lucky enough that we'll be able to see her. But for many people, this is going to be pretty much it.
She's one of my favorites. She's one of the funniest people out here.
She's great.
One of the sweetest souls.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's a very sudden announcement that nobody really knows about.
It's tough. You know, I'm going to share a story with you. She started coming down the field because when I first met her, I said, you know, the players know you and they always talk about her. She said, they don't know me. They're young. And so I said, just come down to the field. And I know that she became very close with Matt Kemp. Juan Pierre, when he was here, he was in center field, and she came down here, and Matt Kemp said, Juan P, Miss Nancy's down here, and Juan ran from center field all the way in just to meet her, and I will never forget that. He was so excited to meet Miss Nancy. So we're going to miss you, Miss Nancy, very, very much, and we actually had a chance to share her bobblehead event this year, and we're going to run that package right now, so let's take a look.
Well, we do a lot of autograph signings with different athletes and celebrities throughout the year. And I actually reached out to Nancy. I was a fan of hers. I mean, you couldn't not go to a game and know who she was. And she was a big part of my life, even though she didn't know that at the time. But she's impacted so many different lives. And I reached out to her on Facebook. And it took a while to get back. I don't know if she did like a background check on me or what, but but it turned out to be a good thing. And I kind of, so we started off, we did a couple autograph signings with her, and then it led to this event here because I thought, you know, there'd be no better way to honor somebody like that. It was an honor to me to be able to do that to her, you know, for her. And it's just been an amazing project that we've been working on together.
I know that you collaborated with her on the look of the bobblehead. How did that sort of evolve?
It was great. As we'd be getting the prototypes back, I would forward them to her, and she's quick on her feet, man. Like, if you send her a text, she's like, bam, she responds.
Yes.
And especially on this, like, she'd get these things. She goes, oh, this is great. But you think they could fix my hair on the left side? Or do you think they can? So it was just awesome. It was a real awesome experience.
And, of course, you've reached out to fans all over. And the line and the people, the response has been overwhelming.
It's been crazy today. I was telling Bill, her husband, earlier that you can always, you know, think about like or dream about something like this happening, but to have it a reality and actually have these fans coming out, and I know they're out here in the hot sun, and I appreciate them waiting, but I think once they get up there, they're going to see why they had to wait so long, and it's going to be worth their wait once they get to meet her.
Well, this is terrific. I mean, to honor Nancy, who is a legendary Dodger.
Yes,
let's face it, she's a legendary Dodger. To be a part of that's very important. Mark has done a a wonderful job in not only promoting this, but for getting somebody out there that, you know, we all want to see and we all have heard for so many years. It's a wonderful, wonderful thing.
And it's nice that the fans really come out to do the support as well, you know.
You know, the Dodger fans are the best.
Yes,
okay? They keep going the tradition, and what bigger tradition is there than Nancy? So anything to do with tradition, they're involved in it, and they will turn out.
This is quite a crowd that's come out for you today.
It's pretty exciting.
It's really
didn't expect
exciting.
That much.
Well, Mark was just telling us how many people have responded, and it's been overwhelming. And they're finally looking for more boxes of bobbleheads back there.
That's pretty. I never dreamed it would turn out this way.
You know, it's really amazing. And I know that the evolution of making the bobblehead was pretty cool. He said he would send you pictures, and you would look at it. And it's come out so great.
Yes, I'm real pleased with the way they came out. I sent him all kinds of pictures, and he picked what he wanted, and I think it turned out very well.
It did. It looks great. I think it looks better, actually, than most of the players that we see, so I think you did good. You know, well, from time to time, we have old friends that come back to the stadium. Usually, they're in a different uniform because they're not playing with the Dodgers and the Angels, but it's always fun to catch up with them. And you've had an ongoing relationship with a number of years. Matt Kemp was here, and tell the story about the night that you were leaving the stadium.
It was one of my first years to come out here, maybe Matt's first or second year, and
yes.
I'm driving on Sunset Boulevard going home, and somebody's yelling at me at a stoplight to roll my window down, and this guy in an SUV is just screaming at me to roll my window down. And I still had Oklahoma plates, my home state, on my car.
Matt's from Oklahoma.
Matt is from around Oklahoma City. I'm from Tulsa. And I look, and it's Matt Kemp yelling at me. And he said, "What part of Oklahoma are you from?" I said, "Hey, Matt, it's me.
Will.
I just saw you a few minutes ago in the locker room." And I said, "I'm from Tulsa." He's like, "All right, cool, peace." Drove off. Saw him the next night. It's like nothing happened. But,
I know, but you
that's,
know.
That's how us Okies are. We want to kind of connect.
Yeah,
down here in
they're bros. So we thought we'd take a minute and have you connect with Matt. So let's take a look.
Now, football season is in full effect. Who you like in the NFL this year?
My 49ers. They're not doing so good, but I still got faith in them. We're going to be okay. It's a long season ahead of us.
Yeah, they lost some players, so it's going
to
be.
Lost a couple players due to some things, but we'll bounce back.
You got a lot of time to watch them. I hope maybe your watching them kind of lifts their spirits a little bit and maybe they'll have some W's.
For sure, man. I'm a big fan, so I'm always going to support, and I'm always going to be a Niner fan to the day I die. So I'm always going to be here.
Now, near and dear to my heart, my alma mater, the Oklahoma Sooners, they're climbing the ranks. Now it's conference season. We start playing West Virginia, they're 23. Baylor, TCU, they're like top five. Do the Sooners got a shot to go to playoffs?
I think they do. I mean, they played some tough games this year already and handled their business. We actually we have a couple Sooners fans on my team. One of our hitting coaches, Zoe, he's a big Sooners fan. So he likes to always talk about them all the time. He keeps me up to date because I usually don't start watching football till baseball season is over with. So now that my season is over, I can watch some more football and start paying attention to my guys.
What are some of your habits on Saturdays watching the Sooners in the offseason?
I just sit there. I love being at home. I made my home to never leave. So for me to just be there and just be in my house and just chill, because I don't get to chill too much during the season.
You get to go back to Oklahoma and visit them?
I do. I actually go at least two or three times a year. I go for Thanksgiving and I go for Christmas and I think one other time before the season starts. So I get back there. It's pretty cold. Don't like it. But, it's there's family there and it's always good to get home.
That is all the time that we have for you on this show. And I think the Dodgers are getting ready to play baseball, so they're going to kick us out of here in a minute, Will.
That's right. But remember, you can watch us anytime, or sometimes just Maria, at playingthefieldtv.com.
That's right. And hey, coming up on our next show, it's going to be NBA basketball starting and NFL football. Maybe we'll have some news about a team coming to LA by then. That would
be
interesting.
It's getting exciting.
NFL. Will still owes me dinner, actually, for a bet we made a long time ago, but I'll save that story for the next show.
Yeah.
Okay, and then, of course, there'll be baseball playoffs to talk about, so lots of stuff coming up.
October, the best sports month. You can't argue that.
It's going to be crazy. All right, thanks so much for watching. I'm Maria Serrao for Will Lupardus, and we'll see you next time.
Thank you.